meditations of our hearts and minds be acceptable to you, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen.
Okay, so I sat down a few months ago to write this sermon, and it didn't happen. Sat down a few weeks ago to write this sermon, it didn't happen. Sat down a few days ago to write this sermon, didn't. Sat down last night to write this sermon, and said, okay, doesn't happen now, doesn't happen ever. So, every time I had sat down to try and write the sermon, one line in particular stood out, and Jesus asked him, what is your name? One thing that I found interesting is how it seems that Luke seems to make this point to mention how dangerous, how destructive and harmful this demon is, then goes on to Jesus asking, what is your name? It's just like, hello, I understand you have a demon. That's cool. So you could probably severely injure me, but you know, I want to know your name. I mean, I'm Jesus and everything, but you know, stop. Jesus makes a point to get to know this person, this man. Let's kind of take a look at what's going on here. So before this, he's in Galilee. Nice, comfortable, mostly Jewish. Pretty good, pretty nice off. And so for this story, he's gone across the sea. The story right before this is where the boat is rocking and just wakes up and he's like, storm, calm down, it's all good, it's all good. So he's come over to this land. It's not the best place for him to be. It's a land of Gentiles. Not the best place. Second, he comes over for this man possessed by a demon. Once again, we run into this whole not safe thing. Also, this demon has been living in the tombs. So, he's not with his community, and he's somewhere generally kind of unclean. So, for a normal person of maybe Jesus' standing in a normal Jewish community, that would be about like 12 billion red flags. That would be the stay away, do not come near, do not do ever in your whole lifetime ever, unless you don't want to be with your community. And also, right after this story, it's right back over to Galilee. So, pretty much came over for what it seems like for this one person. He wanted to heal him, he wanted to know him. So, what is your name? Who are you? How do you define yourself? I don't remember where we heard this from. There's a phrase that me and my dad like to joke around with. One of us will say, find yourself in three words. The other one will respond with, I am a rebel. First time I heard it, I didn't get it. I was like, that's four words. They're like, exactly. It's like, oh, okay. But more to the point, everyone has a definition for themselves. Everyone has a label for themselves, and oftentimes we have labels for others. I read an article on this reading about Legion, the demon-possessed man. He had defined himself by his trouble, by his pain. He chose to look at the negative side of things rather than to search for the light. You know, we'll give it to him. He was possessed by a demon, but all the same, he chose to look at the negative. We all have a choice in how we define ourselves. How do we see ourselves? Do we see light? Do we see dark? Don't answer out loud, but if you had to define yourself, how would you do it? If you had to look at yourself and choose, I don't know, maybe one or two words, what words would you pick? What could you possibly say to sum up your whole existence? And would you be sure of it? Are we sure of who we are? We have singers, dancers, golfers, musicians, gardeners, children, teenagers, adults, mothers, fathers, grandmothers, grandfathers, aunts, uncles. We have all these different words to describe all these different people. That's one thing that is so easy about defining ourselves. There's an infinite amount of words that we can use, but that's also sometimes what makes it the most hardest. You have to find the right word to define yourself. Now, as I was writing that last part, my dad started watching choose for themselves their future. And once they chose that future, there was no going back. So if you chose to be honest, but you're really the biggest liar in all of creation, you're going to have some trouble. So you have to know who you are. Their identities often destroyed them because they didn't know who they were. But there were also others whose identities could not be constricted to one thing. And no one liked that. Their identities were too united for this system, and the system did not like that, so they destroyed them. They didn't like what they were, what they chose, who they were, and they were suddenly destroyed because they didn't like their identities. People judged them without knowing their reasons. It's kind of like we talked about last week. Did the Pharisee judge the woman or her reputation? They didn't like what they did, so they destroyed them. I'm not going to go any further into this, because there's a lot we could say about this, because it's all too real. So, I'm not going to bother, because that's another story, for another time. But, the main person that I could relate to in Divergent was the main character. She struggled to fit in. She struggled to find a place. She didn't know who she was. She took this test to say, "Who am I?" And the test said, "You're too good." She got many answers, but she was only supposed to get one. She didn't understand. She thought something was wrong with her. She had to decide, was she smart, was she brave, or was she selfless? In the end, it turned out that she was all of them. She couldn't turn her back on who she was, no matter how hard she tried. That's one of the hardest lessons to learn, even if it seems the easiest. You can't be someone you're not. You are who you are for a reason. You were made unique and gifted for a reason. Nothing will change that. And you couldn't be different if you tried. Yes, you will grow. Yes, you will learn. You will evolve, but you will always be you. Your identity will never change. So once again, who are you? What happens if we doubt who we are, when we believe we're not good enough, when we think, why? Why is it that this person got the super cool thing and I didn't? Did I do something wrong? Did I mess up? What did I do? We start to doubt ourselves, and to an extreme limit, it can be very bad. I've had my fair share of extreme doubt, and that was a really hard time in my life. I questioned who I was, who everyone I cared about was, and just even who God was. I've only ever been able to tell the story of what happened once without crying, and I came about that close, so I don't think it's ever going to happen. But while doubt can be healthy sometimes, it's good to ask questions. It's good to be curious. But if you start asking too much, it can be fatal. This is one of the most important times to look to God. If we can believe in ourselves, God will believe in us. If we can't believe in ourselves, God will believe in us. It's one of my favorite books of all time. It's a book called Starring Me. It's about this girl who is an atheist. She's trying out for this movie, she's trying out for this show, but what she doesn't know is that the parents of the co-star are looking for a Christian. This whole book is loosely based on Isaac and Rebecca, that story. But she's starting to kind of question the existence of God. There was a book before where she didn't want to have any part in it. She didn't care. She was like, fine, have your religion, but I don't want it. She started to question it. And one of my favorite lines from that book goes something like this. Karen closed the blinds. I don't really believe in God. That's all right, Flora said as she smiled and walked out. Karen took a deep breath. It's nice to hear someone say that. Flora turned to her. God believes in you. Every time I read this, it hits me. Everyone doubts God once, twice, maybe a million times. are, why we are who we are. Yes, he knows the answers to these questions, but that has never stopped him from believing in us. If I was God having to believe in me, or any human for that matter, I would definitely have my doubts. But our identities are strong and secure in God's hands. So when you need help, you need hope, you need a father, you need a friend, look to God. Fathers, you are one of the most relatable people to God. And I will pause to allow time for women everywhere to laugh. But really, I'm serious. Because when we think of God, what do we think of? We think of a father. We think of someone who is strong, confident. Someone we can go to when we need help. As in, like when we did the invocation, God the Father. Father's Day is today. Kids, please remember to give your dads a really big hug. Parents, say thank you to your fathers. Send a prayer to them, thanking them for all they've done. Or if they're here on earth with us, give them a call. Go visit them. Thank them. They may mess up. They may get mad. But know that fathers love you. They're people just like you. And always remember, you have a Father in heaven who loves you and knows just who you are. You are special. You are unique. You are loved. Please, everyone, just take the time today to thank your dad, or even your parents in general. Thank them for helping you find yourself, and for helping you become who you are today. And if you don't mind sharing who you are, there's a poster in the back, on that back table. It says, "Who are you?" Write down a few words. Tell us who you are. Don't write your name. We know what your name is. Write who you are and what describes you.